Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unbound, How Inequality Constricts Our Economy and What We Can Do About It, by Heather Boushey, narrated by Teri Schnaubelt. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to tables, charts, and figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Stand ye calm and resolute, like a forest close and mute, with folded arms and looks which are weapons of unvanquished war. And if then the tyrants dare, let them ride among you there, slash and stab and maim and hew. What they like, that let them do, with folded arms and steady eyes, and little fear and less surprise. Look upon them as they slay, till their rage has died away. Then they will return with shame to the place from which they came, and the blood thus shed will speak in hot blushes on their cheek. Rise, like lions after slumber, in unvanquishable number. Shake your chains to earth like dew, which in sleep had fallen on you. Ye are many, they are few. Percy Bysshe Shelley, The Mask of Anarchy. Preface. In the post-war decades, from the 1940s to the 1970s, the job of economists seemed straightforward. Focus on growth, expect the rest to follow, and provide policymakers with the government revenues needed to soften the harshest effects of the market economy. Since then, devising economic policy has become a lot more complicated. Alongside the traditional questions of productivity and growth are now questions of how to address the increasingly uneven distribution of income and wealth in all their complexity. As I'll lay out, a shift is underway in economics that sheds light on these new concerns, one that must be echoed in how policymakers and the public think about the economy. Even as economics is changing, much of the thinking on the policy side remains trapped in an old set of ideas which don't fit current economic reality. While an emerging generation of economists, many of them featured in this book, are analyzing more readily available data to discern new patterns that change our understanding of the economy, policymakers have yet to get in sync. Too many policy ideas either ignore inequality or assume that the incentives it creates outweigh the negatives. The repercussions, both for individuals and for the economy as a whole, are serious. By using empirical data and following where it leads, rather than deferring to theory, today's economists are questioning whether markets work as predicted. This new body of research now needs to be integrated into everyone's understanding of how the economy works, including those in the economic policymaking community. Case in point, after serving his home state of Kansas in the U.S. Senate for two full terms, Sam Brownback ran for governor in 2010 on what he called a red state economic platform. His agenda consisted almost entirely of lowering the costs of doing business. He won. And, true to his word, his first act as governor after being inaugurated in Topeka on January 10, 2011, was to establish the Office of the Repealer. The mission of this ominous-sounding body was to identify laws and regulations that are out of date, unreasonable, and burdensome on Kansas businesses. Over 2012 and 2013, he signed into law the largest tax cuts in Kansas history. The top state income tax rate fell from 6.45% to 4.90%, and taxes on business profits from partnerships and limited liability corporations, which passed through to individuals, were eliminated. When his tax cuts became law in 2012, Governor Brownback predicted great things. Our new pro-growth tax policy will be like a shot of adrenaline into the heart of the Kansas economy. The new governor of Kansas made big promises, but simultaneously admitted that putting his plan in place would be a real live experiment. The hypothesis was that the middle class would be strengthened as lower taxes and lighter regulation encouraged the wealthy to invest more in Kansas businesses, creating new jobs and fueling economic growth. For those in the top 1% of incomes, Kansans making more than $400,000 a year, the effect of the tax cuts was to pay about $17,000 less on average. Meanwhile, the bottom 20%, making less than $20,000, would actually pay an additional $242 in total taxes, mostly due to the elimination of various tax credits. Brownback told his constituents this new tax plan would ultimately reduce neither government revenues nor government services because it would unleash so much economic growth. These tax cuts would, he said, pave the way to the creation of tens of thousands of new jobs and help make our state the best place in America to start and grow a small business. Once the evidence began coming in, it was clear that Governor Brownback's experiment was failing to deliver on his promises. Instead of reviving the American dream, he presided over a continuing trend of lackluster income gains for Kansas's working families, alongside rising gains at the very top of the income ladder. Menzie Chin, a professor of public affairs and economics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, found that after the enactment of the tax cuts, economic growth in Kansas fell well below its pre-Brownback rate. Indeed, by the spring of 2017, job growth in Kansas was lower than most neighboring states, and not even half the national average. The tax changes also did little to spur business formation. For example, after they were enacted in 2012, the creation of new pass-through businesses, whose profits were no longer taxed at business rates but at their owners' individual tax rates, exceeded its 2011 level for 2 years, but then dipped lower than it had been before. To pay for these ineffective tax cuts, Kansas made cuts to government services in education, pensions, and infrastructure, with the state's general fund spending per resident falling 5.5% from 2012 to 2016. This is only one of the many examples of politicians claiming their policy agendas would restore the American dream and not delivering on that promise. 5 years after Governor Brownback enacted his historic tax cuts, his own party turned on his ideas. The Republican-dominated state legislature saw the experiment for what it was, a failure. In the summer of 2017, opponents gathered a veto-proof majority and rolled back the tax cuts against his will. Yet this prominent example of a failed program of deregulation plus tax cuts for the wealthy did not put an end to similar experiments. On the heels of the Kansas failure, President Donald Trump in 2017 signed a tax bill that expands the federal deficit by $1.9 trillion over 10 years and gives a massive permanent tax cut to corporations, alongside temporary tax cuts to individuals, mostly benefiting those at the top of the income spectrum. And, like Brownback, Trump is focusing his energy on eliminating regulations. Today, it is more than evident that this mistaken approach to intervening in the economy has not delivered for the American people. Simple supply-side thinking by politicians such as Governor Brownback and President Ronald Reagan before him and Trump today reflects a very flawed understanding of how the economy works and is disconnected from the current empirical evidence. We'll see in the course of this book how applications of this interpretation of public policy in Brownback's Kansas and in many other ways across the nation have been economic and social disasters. Indeed, supply-side policies have created perfect conditions for income and wealth inequality to grow and thrive, crimping economic mobility to the detriment of us all. We must reject this pseudoscience. There is a consensus emerging out of the combination of lived experience and scholarly research examining what drives economic growth and stability. This body of work shows that when we enact policies that have the effect of undertaxing top income earners or allowing them to ignore the rules, what we get is not shared prosperity, but greater economic inequality. To believe that pure market mechanics will produce socially beneficial outcomes is to take the theoretical logic of Adam Smith's invisible hand too far. We need to recognize how economic power translates into political and social power, and reject old theories that treat the economy as a system governed by natural laws separate from societies. The idea that the economy is embedded in society was put forth three quarters of a century ago by political economist Karl Polanyi. He argued that the idea of free markets is a utopian myth, since all the freedoms that enable markets to function are secured by a state. In 1944, he critiqued classical economists' faulty belief that the economy has natural laws separate from society's institutions and politics. As he put it, economic society was founded on the grim realities of nature, and thus was subjected to laws which were not human laws. With today's rise in economic inequality and growing sense that the market is not delivering as promised, his praise for the subsequent discovery of society is being revisited. A key insight of Polanyi's analysis relevant to today's economy is that the market cannot be stripped of power relations. The market, like politics more generally, is always contested. This stands in opposition to the idea, especially as it is narrowly interpreted, that market dynamics obey their own laws, separate from the workings of society more generally. New data and evidence on how inequality affects the economy via second-order effects on politics and society underscore Polanyi's conclusion. The way forward starts by asking the critical economic question of our time. How can we grow our economy more equitably and sustainably in the 21st century? The following offers answers. Drawing on interviews with top scholars steeped in the latest empirical evidence, this book presents strategies for delivering strong, stable, and broad-based growth. My purpose is to make sense of the emerging thinking in economics for those who seek to understand these ideas, but who are not embedded in the economics community, and especially for those who seek to take action based on the conclusions these ideas lead us toward. This book builds on the work of my organization, the Washington Center for Equitable Growth. When I took up the challenge 6 years ago of launching this research and policy center, I hoped we could inject evidence-backed ideas about how inequality affects the economy into debates over economic policy. At the time, income inequality in the United States had reached levels last seen during the Roaring Twenties. Yet many policies and ideas to create more opportunities for children and their parents were dismissed as bad for the economy by Washington policymakers. Building and leading equitable growth was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to bring important ideas and policies to the fore. For centuries, economists and their ideas have provided the frameworks that policymakers use in deciding what actions to take. To support exploration of these ideas and ensure that new research is relevant, accessible, and informative to the policymaking process, equitable growth is building a stronger bridge between academics and policymakers. We seek to ensure that the policymaking community sees the changes going on within economics and knows how to make use of these new ideas. To that end, we promote rigorous research on the relationship between economic inequality and economic growth through a competitive grants program that elevates both established and new academic voices from economics as well as other fields, by commissioning papers and by hosting conferences and conventions. Determined not to leave the policy-relevant research we support sitting on the shelf, we deploy our communications and outreach capacity strategically to educate policymakers on matters of economic competitiveness and mobility. Over the past 6 years, our startup has grown into an organization of nearly 40 staff members dedicated to promoting strong, stable, and broad-based growth by advancing evidence-backed ideas and policies. Our steering committee includes Nobel laureate Bob Solo, John Bates Clark Medal winner Emmanuel Saez, and former Federal Reserve Board Chair Janet Yellen, And our research advisory board consists of more than 24 scholars working at the cutting edge of economics. Since making our first academic grants in 2014, we have funded more than 180 scholars nationwide, giving away nearly $5 million in the pursuit of knowledge regarding whether and how inequality affects economic growth and stability. This book summarizes what I have learned from this work and offers one way to make sense of the emerging findings and what they mean for economics and policymaking. My colleagues and I are guided by a hope that more of economic policy will be grounded in evidence of how economies can be made to work for the many, not just the few. This book knits together what has become clear as we've pored over the latest research and worked with the best scholars in the world. It attempts to tell a story that brings this body of work together. The past 6 years have been an incredibly exciting time to be deeply engaged in economics, as perhaps eras of fundamental change always are. I hope you will find the debates equally energizing. Introduction. All happy families are alike. Each unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. Leo Tolstoy. In March 2009, in the darkest days of the economic crisis, the U.S. economy was losing nearly 26,000 jobs each day. Home prices had plummeted over the prior 3 years as the credit-fueled boom of the prior decade fizzled, destroying the value of what, for most families, was their most valuable asset. The burst of the housing bubble left millions unable to pay their mortgages. As over-leveraged homeowners curtailed their spending, the effects pushed the U.S. economy to the brink of disaster and reverberated around the world. Long-standing Wall Street institutions at the pinnacle of the financial market disappeared overnight, along with trillions of dollars of wealth. The global economy was headed, it appeared, into cataclysmic meltdown. By the time the crisis reached its end, 8.7 million jobs were gone, and $12 trillion in household net worth had disappeared. Cities and states, shocked by tax revenue shortfalls, cut back education, healthcare, and other critical spending, laying off tens of thousands of teachers, nurses, fire and police department workers, and other public sector employees. The immediate pain was intense. More enduring is the fact that millions of Americans will never make up for that lost wealth and missed income. The trend toward greater economic inequality continues its seemingly inexorable march, and the share of the U.S. population whose jobs, family incomes, and net assets put them in the middle class remains below the high of the previous century. The middle class remains mired in debt. One group has emerged as strong as ever. Those at the top of the income and wealth ladders have not only fully recovered, but are even better off than before. In stark contrast to the experience of the bottom 90%, the wealthiest 1% of families almost completely regained what they lost during the crisis by 2012. That year, their inflation-adjusted average wealth, not including any funds hidden in overseas accounts, was $13.8 million, just 3.5% below the 2007 peak. Experts had thought this kind of economic crisis couldn't happen in the 21st century. Nobel laureate Robert E. Lucas Jr., for example, made the case in 2003 that the central problem of depression prevention has been solved. The United States had lived through the Great Depression of the 1930s, but we believed we had learned the lessons of an economic catastrophe that left one-third of a nation ill-housed, ill-clad, ill-nourished. That crisis had also begun with the bursting of an asset bubble, stocks in that case, that brought about mass unemployment and the widespread destruction of wealth. Yet, as the first signs of that crisis emerged, policymakers dithered. President Herbert Hoover thought the Depression could not be cured by legislative action or executive pronouncement, and so failed to act as the economy plunged into a downward spiral. That the crisis of the Great Depression was eventually resolved owed much to a set of powerful new economic ideas and a revolutionary effort to collect data to track economic activity implemented during the presidency of Franklin D. Roosevelt, The importance of John Maynard Keynes, who published The General Theory of Employment, Interest, and Money in 1936, is well known. His ideas on how to spur aggregate demand continue to serve as a key plank in fiscal and monetary policymaking. What is less well known is the work, at the same time, by a group of people determined to provide government with better informational tools to measure and analyze economic problems. As the Great Depression unfolded, economists knew they needed a way to translate the suffering they saw all around them into numbers that would accurately reflect the problem and, with luck, illuminate the path forward. They embarked on an ambitious plan to capture complex and vital economic data, and in 1947, the U.S. government published its first set of national income accounts. These provided Congress and the president with the first comprehensive snapshot of economic activity. By the admission of Simon Kuznets, the man who did more than any other to pull it together, the data fell short of revealing the country's overall well-being, but it was a major advance. From the perspective of 2019, it's easy to underappreciate how transformative it was to have data tracking the economy. For the first time in human history, policymakers could design interventions based on a growing body of reliable economic evidence. The systems put in place over the course of the 1940s allow economists and policymakers to gauge unemployment and family incomes and assess how families are faring. For example, we can know today that everyday people's consumption comprises about 70% of our economy, and that any crisis that rocks that 70% threatens to take down the whole economy. Equipped with Kuznets' data and Keynes's ideas, economists believed that they had the tools to solve the problem of how to avert crises. Coming out of the Great Depression, economists developed frameworks and methods that were seen as effective and, for the most important purposes, sufficient. Their work was deemed so vital that economists were given their own agency within the Executive Office of the President of the United States, the Council of Economic Advisers. No other social scientists were elevated in this way. There was no Council of Anthropologists or Committee of Sociologists. Over the course of the 1950s and 1960s, economists churned out textbooks codifying and redefining the data-informed insights that generations of students would learn and commit to memory. All seemed to be going well. The policymaking community coalesced around using gross domestic product as the most important metric to track economic progress. This measure of the sum total of all the goods and services provided within a nation's borders was an important part of the economists' data revolution. While not built to measure well-being, it's an aggregate measure of income, not people's welfare, it quickly became policymakers' shorthand for the state of the nation's economy. In December 1960, when a group of nations came together in Paris to launch the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, they named economic growth as its defining goal and adopted GDP as a key indicator of nations' economic development. The prevailing economic doctrine was summed up in a 1963 speech by President John F. Kennedy when he used the expression, "A rising tide lifts all the boats." The belief that when the economy grows, everyone benefits, would inform economic policymaking for decades to come. The following decades validated this approach. The U.S. economy experienced solid growth in GDP, and the vast majority of Americans benefited. Between 1963 and 1979, U.S. national income grew by an average of 1.7% per year, and most people saw their incomes rise commensurately. Indeed, this growth lifted the boats of the poorest the most. These trends led economists and the policymakers who relied on their advice to the conclusion that a growing economy and good jobs naturally go hand in hand. The policymaking community began to believe that its job was to keep growth in output strong and steady. The rest would follow. The rest is what economists call distribution. That is, how the benefits of economic output are shared, and what everyone else calls living standards. Policymakers believe there might need to be some policy interventions, such as Social Security for the aged and disabled, and unemployment insurance, to ensure that people not able to participate in the market weren't left behind. Certainly, there would also be continued need for a set of legal institutions to enforce contracts. But once those were in place, and as long as policymakers focused on strong, stable growth, the market would take care of the rest. Or so the thinking went. For all these reasons and more, economics was hailed as the queen of the social sciences. Until it wasn't. The economic crisis of a decade ago didn't come out of nowhere. It had been brewing for decades. By the time the crisis hit in 2007, it was readily apparent that living standards were failing to improve for the majority of people, even as great wealth was being created for those at the very top. The institutions that had supported broad-based economic gains, such as labor unions and the government agencies charged with ensuring world-class education, robust infrastructure, and prudent regulation of markets, had been crumbling for many years. This process began in the late 1970s, when the U.S. economy experienced a slowdown in growth and productivity, but this was only the first hint of a far larger problem. Until the end of the 1970s, everyone's living standards grew in line with overall output growth. Then things changed. Between 1980 and 2016, the bottom 90% of income earners, that's 9 out of 10 adults in the United States, experienced income growth that was slower than the national average. Regardless of whether we measure this income before or after accounting for taxes and government transfers, such as supplemental nutrition assistance and other family income supports. Since 1980, workers at the 40th percentile of the income distribution, which today includes many home care workers, bank tellers, and preschool and kindergarten teachers, have seen their incomes grow by just 0.3% per year, from about $26,400 to $29,800 in 2016 in inflation-adjusted dollars. At the other end of the income ladder over the same period, the richest have seen their incomes rise sky high. Someone in the top 0.1%, say a banking executive, would have seen his post-tax income almost quadruple since 1980, meaning that with 1 year's salary, the banker can easily afford to add a holiday home in the Hamptons to his collection of luxury properties and yachts. As Gene Sperling, an economic advisor to Presidents Bill Clinton and Barack Obama, said, "The rising tide will lift some boats, but others will run aground." Even as most people failed to share the gains produced, the economics profession was not yet questioning conventional wisdom or coming to terms with how income inequality affects the economy. Up until the crisis, they and the policymaking community that relies on their advice continued to believe that, even though the economy was no longer delivering shared growth, no fundamental rethinking of the advice given to policymakers was required. How the gains of growth were distributed was important, but not of overriding concern. Economist and former government official Brad DeLong once told me that, when we entered the White House in 1992, the winning faction of economists believed that what was most urgent and doable was to stabilize America's public finances and strike a deal with Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan to keep interest rates low so as to enable a high investment, high productivity, high wage growth recovery. Indeed, the research agenda throughout the 1990s and into the early 2000s focused on why people weren't seeing income gains, not what that trend meant for the economy more generally. Was it technological change? Globalization? A lack of skills? The debate occurred within the general confines of the framework laid out decades before. Even that framework, moreover, had narrowed in some ways. The influence of Keynes and his ideas about the vital role of the government in the economy had waned. Ideas that rested on faith in the market, sometimes described as neoliberal, became more influential, fueled in part by capitalism's Cold War triumphs. Within this intellectual context, economists didn't see that inequality could have larger and quite significant implications. The Great Recession of 2007 to 2009 thus came as a shock to the profession. Economists since have had to grapple with how their models of the economy, to put it mildly, underperformed. We are now learning that the framework within which we have been thinking about how to prevent economic crises and generally improve living standards is broken. Transforming our understanding of economic growth and inequality. This book is about a transformation underway in economics that is thoroughly upending the conventional wisdom about how our nation can deliver strong, stable, and broadly shared economic growth. It describes how economists across the profession are using new tools, such as pioneering empirical techniques and making use of big data, to describe what is actually happening in our economy. I've spent the past decade asking whether high and rising inequality is not only an outcome, but in fact a force preventing us from having the kind of economy that delivers for the many, not just the few. I've built an organization, the Washington Center for Equitable Growth, dedicated to advancing research on these questions, and have had the privilege to work with and learn from researchers across the country and around the world, using innovative approaches to find answers to the many permutations of this basic question. I'll showcase what we can learn from the cutting-edge research exploring different kinds of economic inequality in income and wealth, across firms, by gender and race, and across geographic communities and regions, and how they affect economic growth. A few themes emerge, some well understood and some less so. I'll describe the extensive and impressive new tools economists are using to improve understanding of the implications of inequality for how our economy works. Put together, the evidence shows that inequality doesn't just offend our sense of justice, and it isn't merely a nuisance. When the models and theory are so at odds with the available evidence, we need to open our minds to the possibility that a fundamental change is in play. As University of California, Berkeley economist Emmanuel Saez recently remarked, "When the theory is contradicted by the evidence, you have to go with the evidence." In economic thinking today, change is afoot. We see a rising generation of scholars, informed by new data and sources of empirical evidence, coming to conclusions that upend the conventional wisdom. Real-world observations are undermining the claim that markets left to their own devices reliably deliver socially beneficial outcomes. These analyses are challenging long-held assumptions about how the economy works and the extent to which those workings can be understood in isolation from the larger dynamics of the rest of society. All this is paving the way for a major shift. The new framework starts from the understanding, grounded in the evidence, of the ways that inequality obstructs, subverts, and distorts economic growth. While Adam Smith's famous invisible hand pushes the economy toward broadly beneficial outcomes, economic inequality acts as a bind, thwarting the idealized market processes as it transforms into social and political power. A rising tide can't lift all boats when some can't even get launched and others, pushed off course and deprived of navigation tools, founder on the rocks. Inequality constricts economic growth. This framework exposes dynamics more complex than the conventional economic wisdom of the past can explain. That's the purpose of this book. While it is tempting to embrace the simple tale that a rising tide lifts all boats, we need a more nuanced account. We need to make sense of a large body of evidence, much of which has focused not directly on the question of how inequality affects economic growth, but rather on how inequality affects mechanisms that in turn drive investment and productivity. The reasons that economic benefits are not flowing to families may be disparate, but there are many common themes, which, once fully traced, can reveal new patterns to guide better economic thinking and policymaking. The idea that trends in inequality bear on the workings of economies is fast becoming the consensus view. In 2014, Thomas Piketty's Capital in the 21st Century hit bestseller charts worldwide. A profound expose and critique of inequality, the book touched a nerve, selling more than 2 million copies in more than 40 languages and winning the author what journalists called rock star status. Piketty is, of course, a special case. How many economists become international celebrities? But Piketty is not alone in charting a new course forward for economics. I'll show how he's part of a paradigm shift, to use Thomas Kuhn's famous term, that has economists increasingly recognizing inequality as an important feature of how our economy works, with implications that reverberate across our political institutions and processes, and throughout society more generally. Kuhn, a philosopher of science who studied how scientific revolutions happen, argued in 1962 that in any given era and scientific field, knowledge is accrued and ideas developed within a prevailing paradigm, that is, a set of basic assumptions and respected practices shared by the scholars working to advance that field. According to Kuhn, scientific knowledge isn't accessible as absolute truth. It develops only through the consensus of scholars in a particular field, whose work is occasionally upended by scientific discoveries that challenge existing frameworks and force the paradigm to shift. Groundbreaking, data-driven discoveries are causing just such a revolution in economics today. Emblematic of this is the work being done by one of the world's most important organizations dedicated to economic policy, the International Monetary Fund. Economists there have conducted a series of research studies showing the link between higher inequality levels and more frequent economic downturns. They find that when growth takes place in societies with high inequality, the economic gains are more likely to be destroyed by the more severe recessions and depressions that follow, and the economic pain is all too often compounded for those at the lower end of the income spectrum. Indeed, a number of scholars arguing that economists must take inequality more seriously have backgrounds in the economic issues facing developing countries, where inequality has tended to be higher than in the developed world. Prominent among them are the Massachusetts Institute of Technology's Simon Johnson and Darren Acemoglu, Columbia University's Joseph Stiglitz, and the University of Chicago's Raghuram Rajan and James Robinson. Each has explored how inequality affects macroeconomic and institutional outcomes. Their work also challenges the presumption that economic and political instability is something that nations naturally outgrow as they develop. To the contrary, it may be par for the course in the advanced political economies of the world. One thing that is clear from the emerging evidence is that economic inequality reinforces differences in political and social power, and these in turn affect market outcomes. This directly contradicts the post-war conventional wisdom, based on a narrow interpretation of ideas handed down from Adam Smith, that the workings of a market economy can be isolated from those of surrounding political and social institutions. That is, that economies operate by natural laws that transcend institutional settings. It also marks a contrast with much of what economists have claimed over the past half century, as they've spent untold hours documenting how social and political institutions and practices impede the natural functions of the market. The new evidence tells a very different story about the influence of political and social institutions. While they may have been ignored by standard economic models, these institutions created the potential for markets to deliver broadly shared economic growth from the 1940s through the late 1970s, and have allowed them to create rising economic inequality and instability since then. I don't want to leave the impression that there has been nothing in economic thinking between Adam Smith and Thomas Piketty. All along the way, groups of scholars, both within and outside of economics, have attempted to come up with a more realistic portrait of the economy and how it functions. This has often entailed looking deeply at institutions. Karl Marx sat in the British Library and pored over all the factory reports. Thorsten Veblen did deep studies of the emerging consumer society. John Commons wrote about social policy at the state level in Wisconsin, and the list goes on. But especially since the Cold War, these ideas have been outside the center of the mainstream. Case in point, in the early 1990s, David Card and Alan Krueger developed empirical methods that showed that when policymakers in New Jersey raised the minimum wage, employment in fast food restaurants did not decline relative to neighboring states. Their research was not only groundbreaking and had real-world implications, it directly contradicted a basic tenet of economics that when a price rises, demand falls, bringing to the fore profoundly unsettling theoretical questions. Card won one of the most prestigious awards in economics, the John Bates Clark Medal, in 1995, the same year that this research was published as a book. Yet, he recalls pushback and hostility from the profession, grounded in the bias of a set of theoretical ideas handed down for generations. In his words, "My belief was that this was purposefully to try and defend the American Economic Association from criticism that we were a bunch of left-wing nuts." Indeed, when Krueger passed away in March 2019, his obituary in the Washington Post quoted an observation by University of Chicago economist and Nobel laureate James J. Heckman in 1999. "They don't root their findings in existing theory and research. This is where I really deviate from these people. Each day you can wake up with a brand new world, not plugged into the previous literature." Decades later, Card and Krueger are being celebrated as the leading edge of scholars whose research and methods have fundamentally changed the profession. Card and Krueger's research is just the tip of the proverbial iceberg. From across the profession, evidence continues to mount that we must change our understanding of how the economy works. It's becoming clear that we need to adopt a new framework, one that starts from the premise that unequal access to resources translates into political and social institutions able to obstruct, subvert, and distort the processes that should produce strong and stable improvements in economic productivity and output. Economics must now confront the real-world economy with models that take into account the complexities of economic inequality. There is an urgency to this shift, as many economists and other social scientists have pointed out the limited usefulness of prevailing macroeconomic models and blamed their flaws and omissions for the fact that, even as a grave economic crisis was looming in the mid-2000s, economists lacked the foresight to discern it. Nobel laureate Paul Krugman, now at the City University of New York, summed up the problem, explaining to readers of the New York Times Magazine that economists, as a group, mistook beauty clad in impressive-looking mathematics for truth. The evolution of Smith's invisible hand into natural laws of the economy. Scientific paradigms are grounded in the prevailing consensus about what the evidence shows. The prevailing one, based on the idea that the economy has natural laws, stems from ideas laid down centuries ago by Adam Smith. Smith, living and working in Glasgow, Scotland, in the mid to late 18th century, had a front row seat to the Industrial Revolution. Factories were being built as wealth that had been tied up in entailed estates, handed down from eldest son to eldest son, was freed up and invested in nascent industries. People were moving to towns and cities, forced, in many cases, off land their ancestors had plowed for centuries. The old feudal order was unraveling. Smith's imagination was sparked especially by the scientific discoveries and inventions that were raising living standards and allowing vast fortunes to be built. How was this new wealth being created? Would industrialization benefit everyone or only the rich? In An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, he laid out the dynamics of the modern economy rising up during his lifetime as he saw them. Smith's metaphor of the invisible hand remains influential today. At the core of Smith's theory is an honest assessment of people's desire for wealth. "An augmentation of fortune," he wrote, "is the means by which the greater part of men propose and wish to better their condition." His innovation was to show how individuals' pursuits of profits yield overall social benefits because their self-interest motivates production that would otherwise not happen. Smith put it this way: "It is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own interest." This pithy example packs a punch. In this one sentence, Smith made a compelling case for why, in a market economy, economic growth and well-being for all flows from the incentives of personal gain. When people have the liberty to engage in the economy and pursue their own financial gains as they make the most of their skills and talents, this benefits the whole society, not just those individuals. For their own selfish reasons, Smith's craftsmen make, sell, and profit from their work. As a butcher, brewer, or baker grows richer, others are inspired to find opportunities to generate the same kinds of profits in the marketplace. Take the brewer. Eager to make an income, he invests his capital in a brewery, hires workers, and sets a price for his beer. Whatever profit he turns is his reward for taking on some risk and working hard. The townsfolk gain the pleasure of drinking the beer. Note that if there were only one brewer in town, he might be able to charge extremely high prices and take home a lot of profits. This might create or exacerbate inequality between the brewer and townsfolk. Eventually, it might lead to economic and political instability. Recognizing this, Smith specifies the other key element of a successful market economy: competition among sellers. In the competitive market economy he describes, there is free entry and exit of people and capital, and no single actor has power over the others. In such an economy, other wealth-seeking people are able to see how much money the brewer makes and can spot the opportunity to build their own brewery, assuming they can access the capital to do so, and lure customers away from their rival by selling their beer at a lower price. Both brewers will profit less than the original one did before, and inequality will be capped. In the words of one economic historian, Robert Heilbronner, "It was Smith's great achievement to show how the mechanism of competition would bring about a state of economic provisioning as dependable as any provided by state command, and a great deal more flexible and dynamic." This notion of competition is not the same as the so-called perfect competition theory of today's economics textbooks. Smith made use of a more common-sense understanding of what happens when sellers are allowed to compete for profits. This, in a nutshell, is Smith's invisible hand. It would be difficult to overstate the revolutionary nature of Smith's ideas. By celebrating the positive public outcomes of self-interest, constrained by market competition, he turned the third deadly sin, greed, from vice to virtue. This was a sharp departure from the prevailing Christian ideology of the day. Smith argued in The Theory of Moral Sentiments that the deity instills in human nature certain passions, including a passion for wealth accumulation that exceeds purely rational considerations, which invisibly motivate people to act in ways that advance the interests of society without intending it, without knowing it. Eager for the products of the butcher, brewer, and baker, we address ourselves not to their humanity, but to their self-love, and never talk to them of our own necessities, but of their advantages. It turns out that, as the character Gordon Gekko puts it in Oliver Stone's 1987 film Wall Street, "Greed, for lack of a better word, is good." In Smith's free market, the selfish pursuit of wealth is socially beneficial. It's also difficult to overstate the appeal of Smith's ideas. The bare-bones story is beautifully simple and intellectually satisfying, connecting individual liberty to collective progress in one complete logical system. Smith developed a theory of how allowing markets to work freely delivers broad-based improvements in living standards so that economic growth and distribution go together. In the two centuries since the publication of The Wealth of Nations, economists have formalized Smith's ideas of the natural laws of the economy into mathematical models. Starting with the actions of individuals, they developed a set of theorems showing that market forces left alone to operate would generate outcomes that were, in some sense, economically optimal and generally seen as fundamentally fair. The notion that the market had its own rules and were both logically consistent and socially beneficial came to be treated as scientific fact. In the late 1800s, American economist John Bates Clark, whose name is attached to one of the highest honors in economics today, gave the economics profession the marginal productivity theory of distribution. It predicts that, in a competitive economy, individuals' wages will be proportional to their productivity. As a result, Clark wrote in 1891, what a social class gets is, under natural law, what it contributes to the general output of industry. In the 1950s, economists Kenneth Arrow and Gerard de Brieux provided the math to support Adam Smith's idea that there is a general equilibrium corresponding to an optimal allocation of resources. In an ideal world, their equation showed, when the butchers, brewers, and bakers all produce and sell in competitive markets, social welfare increases for them and for the consumers they sell to. In a set of mathematical proofs, now known as the two fundamental theorems of welfare economics, they established that a perfectly competitive market would arrive at a point where no further improvement could be made to any person's outcome without leaving some other person worse off. At that point, it would reach its Pareto efficiency, named after the 19th century Italian economist Vilfredo Pareto, who pioneered the study of income distribution in an economy. They also found that, under some conditions, any Pareto-efficient allocation of economic resources can be supported by a competitive equilibrium with transfers to those who are worse off. The Pareto efficiency principle implies that the market can deliver optimal outcomes, assuming we agree with the mathematician's definition of optimal, and that we should judge the best outcome to be the one that achieves an overall maximum, so that no individual's outcome could be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.